All right. Welcome. We're glad to have you today, and we praise the Lord for this good sunshine. We've got a good group here at church. We are glad to have you, and we have some first-timers with us. We're glad to have you as well, and praise God for it. Before I pray and do an opening prayer, let me just give you a little bit of an update that Roy Howell's in the service. I want you to pray for Roy, as he will be receiving a pacemaker on Friday. So let's pray for Roy. And also, I'll publish this before this evening, but tonight at 6:30, for anybody that would like to get back out, we're just going to do a special time of prayer. When people come in, there'll be instructions, they'll pick up a sheet, that kind of thing, and we'll encourage those that are at home maybe just to take some time and just slip away and be quiet at home and pray. And we're praying specifically for several things. One of them is that God would lead us as we step back into small groups, that He would protect us as we get back to Sunday school. Secondly, we're praying for revival in April with David Burton. Folks, it's hard to believe, isn't it, that Easter is April 4th. So it's the year has just really flown by, even though it seems like there were times when it drug. Here we are a year away from standing, and last year we're hoping we could get back to church. And also, I want us to pray for our nation. If you've been watching any news at all, and some equality bills and things like that, some of this stuff directly adversely affects the gospel and the preaching and the teaching of it, and who you can hire, and some things that look like coming down the road are going to be mandated. So we've just got to pray that God continues to give wisdom to those that are making these decisions. And we have to make sure that we're determined as a church that we're going to continue to preach the gospel and do that in love. Amen. Remember, our enemy is not somebody who disagrees with what we believe. The enemy is the devil. The devil's a liar. And what he wants to do is get people away from the things of God. And we need to turn from the devil and turn back to the Lord. Amen. And so, remember, I've said this more than once. I love when Renee fixes beans and potatoes. Basic staples of growing up. And there is nothing wrong with a church returning to the basics of the gospel. And what is that? Preaching the Word of God, sharing the Word of God, praying, and asking God to do something that we can't. And I think we've tried so many new things over the years as the church. It's time to get back to the basics of the gospel, because innovation and all this new stuff really hasn't lasted. Things change with the wind, but the gospel of Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Amen? So that's who we proclaim today. That's who we're going to ask to speak to our hearts. So you here and those at home, join us in prayer. As we open, dear God, we thank you. We ask that you would have your way in this time together today. Thank you for these who have taken time to be with us, and pray for everyone who will watch this message, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just empower and remind us of how much you love us. And today especially, remind us that you provided a way for us to know you. We thank you for the cross of Calvary, and we thank you for the picture of the heavenlies that we get when we look at the earthly tabernacle in the Old Testament. I pray for Roy as he looks at Friday, God, and just ask you would wrap your arms around our church family, those that are healing, those that are struggling, and ask that you would be with us today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. All right, I want you to take your Bible and open to Exodus chapter 26. Exodus chapter 26. And just as I have mentioned, we are in a study on the tabernacle of the Old Testament, the tent of meeting, this transferable, temporary design that God gives the children of Israel with strict instructions of how to worship, how to approach Him, how to be forgiven of sin. And the tabernacle would move with the people, all right? And God, for those of you that might be joining us for the first time, I'll give you a quick little review. We recognized in week one that to enter the courtyard of the tabernacle, the outer court, you had to come through a gate. There was a fence around that outer court all the way around the tabernacle facility, and that represented that there's separation between God and man. But you could come through a gate, and the gate represents God makes a way. It represents Jesus. It represents an open door. And you and I recognize today that in order to come to God, to have a relationship with God, it only comes through Christ. And in the picture of the tabernacle is a picture of God opening the door. Of God opening the door. After we've entered from the outside into the tabernacle through the gate, you proceed past something called the brazen altar. You cannot approach God without a sacrifice. And then the brazen laver, it's where we get the word lavatory. It's where you have to be clean. And would we not recognize today that God wants us to be close and God wants us to be clean? And the way you and I do that is we go to God through this high priest we're going to talk about today, the Lord Jesus Christ, who petitions and intercedes for us before the Father. Because of His great love for us, God made a way. As you make your way through the door into what's called the holy place, a place where only priests could go, you pass the golden lampstand, and that represents Jesus being the light. It represents light that the priest would need to do their functions. It's a light that would never go out. Across from it was the table of showbread. The table of showbread represents that Jesus is the bread of life. I love what one person said about finding Christ and sharing the gospel. That evangelism, you know, what is evangelism? Sharing the good news, right? The gospel. Evangelism is one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. I love that. I love that. And then lastly, last week we looked at this altar of incense. And the altar of incense represented the prayers of God's people ascending to heaven, ascending to God. It's also interesting that this altar of incense was the last thing that you would encounter, or the last thing the high priest would encounter before he would step through a veil that would be into a room which is called the Holy of Holies, or the most holy place. And it's where that high priest, on the Day of Atonement, one time a year, would offer a sacrifice, offer, sprinkle blood, we'll talk about the mercy seat, for the people of Israel. Yom Kippur is the day that you would see on a Jewish calendar, and it would be the offering of the blood for the forgiveness of sin for the people. You'll say, Brother Greg, that sounds fascinating. It is fascinating, but I want to remind you as we look at the Word of God today that when Jesus came and died on the cross to pay for our sin, something supernatural happened in the temple. And the veil that separated man from God is torn from top to bottom. And I love that because it reminds us that God is the one who did it. And it's almost as if the door is open and God says, welcome. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So let's take this, let's pick this up at Exodus chapter 26. And I want you to be reminded of this as we look at the Holy of Holies, because the Holy of Holies has something in it called the Ark of the Covenant. So far, we've taken this, it's like a tour, right? We've gone from outside in, one step at a time. But the truth is, the very first article constructed was the Ark of the Covenant. Now, that's an important point. Why? Because the Ark of the Covenant represents the presence of God. And now we're looking at the veil that separates man from God. All right? Exodus chapter 26. Let's just begin with verse 31. You shall make a veil woven of blue, purple, and scarlet thread and fine woven linen. It shall be woven with an artistic design of cherubim. You shall hang it on the four pillars of acacia wood overlaid with gold. Their hooks shall be gold upon four sockets of silver. And you shall hang the veil from the clasp. Then you shall bring the Ark of the Testimony. That's the Ark of the Covenant. Then you shall bring the Ark of the Testimony in there behind the veil. The veil shall be a divider for you between the holy place and the most holy. Now, let's stop there for a minute. In front of the veil is the altar of incense. Behind it was one piece of furniture behind the veil. And it's the Ark of the Covenant. The veil separates two rooms. The most holy place where the priest served and the Holy of Holies. The most holy place is called the Holy of Holies and the holy place where the priest served. The holy place was 30 by 15, and the Holy of Holies was a square room of 15 by 15. Okay? Now, that's interesting, because if we're looking at the tabernacle as being a picture of something heavenly, the Bible reminds us of the dimensions of heaven. In Revelation 21:16, the Bible says the city is laid out as a square. We sing songs about it. I'll see all my friends in Hallelujah Square. Its length as great as its breadth, and to be measured, the city was measured with a reed, 12,000 furlongs. Its length, breadth, height are equal. And most believe that's somewhere around 1,500 miles. Less than 1,500 miles. Square. This beautiful city of God. Now, I really believe sometimes, even as Christians, we get into a mindset that when we read an obituary in the paper and we don't know the person, sometimes we don't think much about it. But when you read that obituary and it's a loved one, a personal friend that you know, or when we read the news of a little six-year-old boy that is killed, is missing, and killed, how in the world can we not be affected by death? And tell you the truth, folks, I hope you understand this. I've done so many funerals as a pastor that if you're not careful, it can just become a job rather than a ministry. And I'm telling you, every time you stand at a casket, somebody's grieving. Somebody's grieving. So that brings me to this point. Do you really believe heaven is real? I believe in heaven because the Bible promises it. It's not the figment of a preacher's imagination trying to make the crowd feel good. As a matter of fact, if you're preaching the gospel, people who do not know Christ will be uncomfortable when they hear the gospel because they'll recognize they're not ready for this place called heaven. Heaven is a prepared place, and here's what the Bible says. Eye hath not seen, nor has ear heard, nor has entered into the hearts of man the things which God has for those who love Him. We can't even imagine how wonderful heaven is. As a matter of fact, if you've lost a loved one who's in heaven, they wouldn't come back if they could. They're waiting on you. Amen? They're waiting on you. I was thinking of the lyrics to some song. I don't think it was one we heard earlier. But the name of the song is by Mark Bishop. Are you familiar with John chapter 11? If I say John chapter 11, does that trigger anything in anybody's mind? Okay, I'll help you. Lazarus. Okay. Also, John 11:35 is Jesus wept. Mark Bishop sings a song and says this, and now don't send me notes of theology, okay? But in his song, he sings that he wrote that Jesus wept because he had to send Lazarus back. Think about that. Think about that. How wonderful heaven is. And those in heaven would not come back. They are waiting on us to join them. And I know you have loved ones. And Dwayne and Bill, I know. We know where Dorothy is. Amen. And you have loved ones that are there. And I don't want us to ever get over the fact that heaven's a real place. Jesus describes it. And then Paul writes about it. And then John in Revelation, as he's revealed this wonderful picture, we get the understanding of the dimensions of heaven, the beauty of heaven, the wonder of heaven. And, you know, the Bible says in Revelation that the tree of life is there. And I want you to be reminded that in Genesis, man had access to the tree of life to live forever. But because of sin, it separated man from God. And from Genesis to Revelation, man's been trying to get back to God. And only through Christ that happens. And you find it there again in heaven, the tree of life, the promised place to be with the Lord. I love to sing about heaven. I love to read about heaven. Sometimes heaven and preaching it, heaven is a place that gets more confusing the more you preach it and study about it, because it's so wonderful and the promises that God has. So the Bible says it's laid out in a square like the Holy of Holies. And there's only one who can enter. Okay, let's just lay that out there. There's only one who can pay the price for our sin. He did it on Calvary's cross. Amen? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 23, therefore it was necessary that the copies of the things in heaven should be purified with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. So the earthly tabernacle, the picture of the temple, is a replica of heaven. And the Bible says heaven is even more wonderful than these. So the tabernacle was a pattern that God would use for His dwelling place so that we could understand. Now the veil into the Holy of Holies. It was much like the gate. That's what got people into the courtyard. And it was much like the door where the priest would come in. But there was one exception. It had embroidered cherubim. These angelic beings. It was almost as if they were overlooking the things of God, the very presence of God. They were protecting the inner room where God was. How do we know that? Because the penalty for entering the Holy of Holies outside of being the high priest would be death. God wasn't playing around. He wasn't playing around. So after the wilderness wanderings, after the establishment of the nation of Israel, Solomon built the first temple. And the only original piece from the tabernacle to go into the temple was the Ark of the Covenant. The other things were new things. Now, mark your Bible here, and let's go to Matthew chapter 27. Verse 50. Matthew 27, verse 50. Are you with me? Okay. You don't sound like you're with me. Are you with me? Yes. Amen? Okay, good. Matthew chapter 27 is the wonderful picture, the love of God dying on the cross for our sin. Jesus speaking out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And now I want to jump down to, let's just read it, okay? Let's just pick it up 49. They said, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come save him. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Okay, here we go. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth quaked, and the rocks were split, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who have fallen asleep were raised. I've always had a little, not a problem, but understanding this, because I always thought, according to 1 Corinthians 15, that Jesus was the first fruits of the resurrection. But the answer to that is in the next verse, right here. And coming out of the graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So Scripture's not contradicting itself here. It's answering itself that Jesus is the first fruits of the resurrection. Now, how do we do that? How do we, especially you gardeners, what are first fruits when we have a garden? Norma? Okay. Jerry, what's the first fruit in your mind when you garden? Okay. See, Jerry's, he's talking about things that come, that you plant early, right? Right? And folks, my dad, if you don't know my mom and dad personally, they're country. They grew up in East Tennessee. My dad's always been, he's always had a green thumb, Bill, very similar to you, and could make anything grow. And, you know, when I started putting in a garden years ago, the first one I had on my own in Camden, one of our deacons who's now in heaven, named Clyde Spradling, said, Greg, Brother Greg, would you like me to plow a garden for you? I said, yeah, I want to plant a garden this year. And I went home from church that day, and folks, it was about twice as big as I thought it was going to be. I mean, it was a garden. And I began to get a bad rap from the church of like having the garden of Whedon. One year we went on vacation and harvest was coming in and it was late in the summer, and you know how you get sometimes, you just got to get away and I don't care what comes in, we're going. And we came back and the ladies in the church had picked every bean, strung them, broke them, and canned them for us. What a blessing that was. But first fruits are, to me, when those tomatoes start ripening, that one I'm picking and I'm giving to somebody to show you, hey, it's ripe. Or those beans start coming in, or Dad taught me, and those early things you plant, I think for us was like, tell me if I'm wrong, like lettuce, onions, potatoes, because they can withstand, I guess, the temperature if it's cool or something. But how many times have you planted something and nothing's come up? And then you realize there's a problem. You realize something has happened. Jesus is the first fruit. He rose from the grave, and the Bible says you and I as believers will follow him. So when that first fruit starts coming in, you expect more to follow. And that's the picture of the resurrection. And you read all about that in 1 Corinthians 15. That's one neat thing about living in the country, isn't it? So let's go back to Exodus and be reminded that God had a plan, and in tearing the veil, he had a plan, and that was for man to be able to approach him. All right? What would be the purpose of that? The Hebrew writer says it this way, Hebrews 4:14. Seeing then that we have a great high priest, referring to Jesus, who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we don't have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but we but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Who? Jesus. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And then Hebrews 10:19 says this, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus. So if the Ark of the Covenant represented the presence of God and only the high priest could enter, the Bible says you and I can come boldly to the throne of God because of the blood of Jesus. That's good news. Hebrews 9:8 says, the Holy Spirit indicating that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. The veil was meant to be temporary until the way of God was made clear. And the way of God was made clear by Jesus and His sacrifice on the cross of Calvary. I praise the Lord for that. So the Ark of the Covenant. You know, in the Old Testament, when the Ark moved, the people moved. Remember, the Ark of the Covenant was never to be touched with your hands. It would always be held with poles that had was attached or run through these rings. And you can kind of get the picture of men carrying it as they would go forward. The hammered gold on it was a beautiful picture of the purity of God. And keep in mind, God wasn't playing games about His presence. He wasn't playing games about His presence. The Ark of the Covenant was the most central and most sacred item in the tabernacle. The presence of God. The Bible says in 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 6, then the priest brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place. Here it is when it's moved into the temple, into the inner sanctuary of the temple, to the most holy place, under the wings of the cherubim, representing the protection and the sanctity of the ark. It was used when other things were replaced. Now, you all help me. What are some things that have been hard for you to replace? What are things that are hard for us to replace sometimes in life? Think about something that means something to you, something sentimental. I'll just speak as a man. I'll speak for us guys. Sometimes people say, "Brother Greg, you got a lot of suits. Is that a new suit?" No, I just make suits look different by ties I wear with them. But I have more comfortable suits than others. Are you with me? Some that you would rather wear than others. Why? Because of the way it fits. So sometimes we get comfortable with things and it's hard to replace. How about that old lazy boy chair in your house? And finally you just have to get rid of it. And man, it's been broken in. It just fits you like a glove and it's hard for you. Or how about that old vehicle that you've had for so long, or that old pickup truck, and finally you get to the point where you just have to get rid of it. Now, you'll notice I'm not talking about getting rid of husbands and wives here, okay? But I'm talking about things that are temporary. And isn't it interesting that the Ark of the Covenant was what went to the temple? Because the presence of God is not temporary. When you give your life to Jesus Christ, you're saved. Your relationship with Christ is sealed, okay? Sophie, it would be like, here's the picture. You probably don't ever disobey your dad, but maybe you have. Maybe you will one day. That doesn't mean that you're no longer your dad's daughter. What it means is the fellowship isn't quite what it should be. The relationship is settled. And when you give your heart to Christ, our relationship's settled. And what God wants is us to have good fellowship. So how do we have that? By trusting God daily to keep us clean, for asking the high priest, the Lord Jesus, to forgive us for our sin. You don't have to bankroll sin and come to church on Sunday and unload it on me, and I don't have to unload it on you. We have a high priest who is available, and we can take it to him right when it happens. And God will hear us and forgive us based on who he is and what he's done. The Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant had a lid, or some refer to it as a slab. It was a covering made of pure gold, and it was called the mercy seat. And when you think about the presence of God, there's no better name for something around the Ark of the Covenant than the mercy seat of God. The Bible is a reminder that God wants to meet with us. And in Exodus chapter 25, look back, if you will, to verse 22. "And there I will meet with you, and I will speak with you from above the mercy seat." So the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies to make atonement for the sins of the people, and he would sprinkle blood on that lid at the mercy seat. That blood would come from a sacrificed bull. Oftentimes, have you ever heard the word scapegoat? Here's a good picture. So if someone says, "They're just trying to make me the scapegoat. They're trying to put the blame on me." All right? Here's a picture of a sacrifice. Two animals are brought. One is killed. One has to be killed. One has to be sacrificed. The blood of that animal would also be placed on the head of another, and that animal would be led into the wilderness. Here's the picture. Your sins are paid for. Your sins are removed. They often would call the animal that would be led away the scapegoat. I wonder if the scapegoat would ever come wandering back into town, and you see the blood on his head, and I'm sure they made a way that would never happen. But that's the picture, that your sins have been forgiven and your sins have been removed. Are you glad of that? I'm glad that God doesn't dangle my mistakes in front of me all the time. You're driving in a car and you look over at that side mirror on the passenger side. What do most of them have in small print on that mirror? Objects are closer than they appear, right? If God were to dangle our mistakes in front of us, they would be bigger than we think they are. Have you ever looked at a mirror, like one of those mirrors that distorts you, like your shape? I remember the first time we saw those at a beach or somewhere, and I was a little boy, and I thought it was the funniest thing I'd ever seen in the world. And you'd walk back, you know, and you'd have a big long face, and it's distorted. Sometimes we get a distorted picture of sin. Remember, we're talking about this in James. James was writing and telling us, "Hey, you are so much more worried about somebody else's sin than yours that you're not even living like a Christian." Mercy seat. The Hebrew word for it is a place of covering. So it's a reminder that our sins are paid for. And it's a place, here's a good King James word for us. It's a place of propitiation. Okay? We've heard that word. Propitiation means to appease or make provision. So when the Bible says in Romans 3:25, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness. So plug it in. Whom God set forth as a provision by his blood, Jesus. The Hebrew writer writes in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17, "Therefore, in all things he has had to be made like his brethren, that he might be merciful and a faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people," Jesus. So when Jesus died on the cross, satisfactory payment was made for our sin. Have you ever bought something and only to realize it cost you more than you thought? Or recognize that through a series of payments, you're paying much more than it actually cost? When Jesus died on the cross, God was satisfied with the payment. And that's the difference in Christianity and religion. Religion is me trying to be good enough, somehow do enough, be religious enough to get to heaven. Christianity is me never being good enough, God doing it all and paying a debt for me I can never pay myself. Jesus is a propitiation for our sin. That's exactly what that means. 1 John 2:2, and He Himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the whole world. What's that mean? That Jesus died for the person who's not a believer. Sadly, that person's never received what God did for him yet. Don't give up on people. Don't give up on somebody and say that they're a hopeless case. God can crack the toughest nut. The Holy Spirit can break any heart. He can do whatever He wants to do. And our prayer is that we would just continue to be faithful to share that message and trust God with the results. And don't get discouraged and quit. I've told this story a few times. When I was in college, I played basketball. I thought I deserved more playing time. And I got aggravated. We were in Vincennes, Indiana. I got aggravated after a game, went and talked to my coach after that game, and I said, I said, as wise as a 18-year-old could sound, I said, I'm not getting a fair shake. This is not worth it. I'm quitting. And you know what he told me? He said, I don't want you to quit. I want you to go home and talk to your dad before you make a decision. So we got home. I sat down with my dad, and what do you think my dad said? Son, you just do whatever you think's right. No, he didn't say that. He said, you're not quitting. You're quitting. You've worked too hard. You're not quitting. You just keep digging, and you keep working, and you make them play you. Don't quit when you're praying for that loved one, praying for that kid, that friend, that wayward relative. Listen, don't quit. Just be faithful. Just continue to lift them up. And I'll tell you what, I pray I will die somebody who's praying for someone who doesn't know Christ. And it might be a relative, it might be your neighbor, might be somebody that you've said that they're hopeless. Well, God sees opportunity in every hopeless case, and I'm grateful for that, aren't you? I'm grateful for that. Let me close with this. The whole world, He loves the whole world. 1 John 4:10, in this is love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us. And He sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sin. Jesus came and died because of His love. So on the Day of Atonement, the high priest, Aaron, when you look at the Old Testament, would enter the Holy of Holies. He would sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat, and it would make atonement for the sins of Israel. The picture is God's holiness demands that sin be paid for completely. God has made a way to justify a sinner. Justification, just as if I had never sinned. And the Bible says in 1 John chapter 2, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And He Himself is the propitiation for our sins, not for ours only, but also for the whole world. The recurring theme in Scripture is that God loves this world. So I want to encourage you this week to tell somebody, to share it with somebody. You say, Greg, where do I start? Put you a few steps to peace with God tracks in your pocket, and when God opens up a door, whip one out and say, hey, let me share a good word with you. I like that track, and I'll tell you why. Number one, it's from Billy Graham. So a lot of times, the lost world, they know who Billy Graham is, but it also recognizes that there's a problem, there's a barrier, and it's called sin. And the only thing to bridge the gap is the cross. Folks, listen, would you agree with me? We're not trying to make everybody Baptist. We're trying to make sure you're a Christian. So that's the picture. Next week, we're going to look inside the Ark of the Covenant, okay? For the sake of time, we're not going to step into it today. But next Wednesday morning, we'll look at the contents, okay? So I appreciate you being here. I'm going to close this in prayer. And as I close in prayer, I want to talk to anybody that's here or watching this who may not know Christ as their Savior. I was a religious kid who went to church every Sunday with my family, but every time the pastor gave an invitation, I was under conviction. I didn't know if I was a Christian. And if anybody's here, anybody's watching that's unsure of your salvation, you can be sure. Amen, church? You can be church. As a matter of fact, 1 John 5:13 says, "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you may know you have salvation, that you know you're saved." So let's bow our heads. And if you don't know Christ and God's dealing with your heart, maybe knocking, would you let Him in? You can do that by just being honest in your heart and praying in your heart. Dear God, thank you for loving me. I realize that I'm one of the whosoevers. And I ask you to come into my heart right now. And please forgive me of my sin. I believe you died for me. And I'm asking you to save me right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I want to encourage you, if you prayed that prayer, go to our website, CamdenCornerOfHope.com, and you'll see a guest info button. It'll give you an opportunity to share your decision. And you can let us know that comes directly to me. And I'd love to get some things in your hands. Also, I want to encourage you, there's been a great response so far to the water coming in to help Texas. Be reminded that Friday is the cutoff. And we've even doubled what we've had as Dwayne Powell brought a skid of water today. So we've got some work to do, and we're going to be able to bless some people. So thank you for your help. Friday is the cutoff. So get it here as soon as you can. God bless you. Have a good day. Thank you, folks. Thank you for being faithful.